Thank you. So, hi, and thank you so much for inviting me. So, I'm here from Stockholm, Sweden. So I will start by talking a little bit about my background and then move on to my practice. Okay, so this is me together with my best friends in a place called Akalla in the 90s. So Akalla is a suburb of Stockholm. So this is what my surrounding looked like when I was growing up. This was my reality. But this reality was not what the visual culture that surrounded us looked like. It looked totally different. Growing up, I didn't really have any connections to art or the cultural sphere. My impressions and frames of reference came from completely different worlds. With parents from Iran living in Sweden, I had one foot in the Swedish culture and one in the Persian. So even without the connection to art and culture, I quite early understood that one part of my bank of references wasn't really accepted within the dominant traditions of aesthetics. This was clear when looking outside of my local sphere. So the modernist architect Adolf Loos wrote in his book Ornament and Crime, quote, "Ornament is wasted labor and hence wasted health." And modern people with modern nerves, does not need ornament. On the contrary, they abhor it. This makes it clear who the modern and the good man is in relation to aesthetics. It also defines how the dominant modernist tradition rejects what does not fall within the context of clean and scaled, i.e. cultures such as the Persian and very many others outside the Western culture. But this juxtaposition of style characterized me and my friends and influenced us and our view of what was considered accepted, good taste, and so on. But then, back in the suburb Akalla, something huge happened to me. My childhood friends from Akalla school, Midi Maxi and Efti, which was one of the first Swedish hip-hop girl groups in the 90s, became world-famous artists overnight. And I had my first strong visual memory. I was struck by the visual aesthetics surrounding them, in which I also felt included. References that also appealed to all of my friends. So I would say that Midi Maxi and Efti was a major contributing factor to me even considering an artistic profession later in life. Of course, in combination with other important factors, but it was around that time that I was struck by the power of visual communication, how it can create including and excluding situations. A lot later, I finally took the step towards design education, and I found that my design studies in Sweden provided me primarily with practical skills. I trained my creative ability and learned to use the necessary tools of a visual communicator. But what the education did not provide me with was methods of understanding processes of inclusion and exclusion. With this, I mean the important process of realizing and reflecting on different choices based on the fundamentals of power analysis connected to visual communication. In short, my ability as a graphic designer to reflect the society we live in. So this gap is something I choose to use in my work. In 2008, I founded my studio, which is a studio, a platform, and an artistic research project. I worked both solitary and in collaboration with others. I mix commissions with projects that I initiate myself. A central part of my work process is about illuminating power structures in order to broaden the palette of graphic design, to create space for other forms of expressions, logics, and references within the field, to go beyond Eurocentric and dominant traditions of thinking and making within graphic design and visual communication. I believe there is too little complexity within graphic design and typography. According to the dominant traditions, especially in Scandinavia and other parts of the Western world, the form is subordinate to the content. So the images that I was supposed to show now, you won't see. So this is what you will see for some time. So I would draw the work integrated with form and content without hierarchical opinion, to add instead of removing and simplifying. I work in an explorative way, and I like to work with people that might not be expected within the context of the project. Together we explore different subjects and tell visual stories that are perhaps not usually told. For me, my work is often about providing a space for these stories. So I use typography, mostly created by women, as a supporting element in my work. And I am interested in what the different shapes of letters and fonts connote and why. How come certain fonts are classed as neutral and others not? How can a font even be seen to be neutral? And what does the word neutral mean in the context? In describing the updated Helvetica Neue, Linotype refers to the typeface as, quote, the quintessential sans-serif font, timeless and neutral, and can be used for all types of communication. But neutral for whom? Being able to argue why certain aesthetics are valued more highly than others requires historical knowledge and the ability to draw parallels to visual culture. So now we've come to this image. So I have chosen three cases to go more into details and to reflect on my design choices with focus on typography. So I will start with Novelix. Novelix is a series of short stories, and this series is on the subject to flee. The stories are told by four different voices and four generations of migration. Depictions that extend from World War II to today. I chose to translate all Swedish headlines into the author's mother tongue, so the titles are in two languages. The Swedish titles are typed with the font Albertus, created by a German typographer Bertolt Wulpe, who fled Nazi Germany in World War II. Wulpe drew the font during his time in exile in Britain. The author's names are typed with the free font Common Sans, a specially designed typeface with a built-in function that automatically replaces the word refugee with human. Common Sans is founded on the premise that, quote, being a refugee is a temporary status, being a human is permanent, and is a response to the ongoing migrant crisis. I mean, there's so many slides that... Okay. So the next case I want to talk about is Unga Clara, which means young Clara. Unga Clara is one of the world's leading norm-creative theaters that works in an investigative manner based on a child's perspective. It is also one of the national scenes in Sweden. So my aim has been to create an identity that is both playful and norm-challenging, as well as inconsistent and non-static. We have explored a separatist form in our subcontractors, such as the photographer, assistant, carpenter, the printer, the binder, etc., all women. The font is a central part of the visual expression. So we started by developing a custom-made typeface as a graphic platform. We emanated from an existing font drawn the same year that Unga Clara was founded. Consciously, we chose a modernist font drawn by a white man as a base for the typeface. to then decompose and give new character with details based on the theater Unga Klara's perspectives. And with us as creators of the new typeface, it became a symbolic act. So then we created 7x3 unique characters to juxtapose the font. The unique characters were drawn from scratch, one character for each letter in the name Unga Klara. These characters replaced the letters UNGAKLR in the font in all headings when communicating Unga Klara publicly. It symbolizes that Unga Klara is non-static and in constant change. We have developed a symbol and several logos. The symbol is also available as an animated GIF for use in social media. And it also exists as a physical object. We contacted the carpenter Moa Ott, who created the symbol in wood based on a three-dimensional prototype that we developed. The idea is that the symbol will be presented in many different materials and sizes as they are placed in the foyer. Cheap material is preferred. In addition to this new visual identity, I also create visual material for about 4 performances every year at the theater. Each performance has a unique visual identity, and we mainly work graphically with no images at all, and with the typography at the center. I won't be able to talk about every single piece, but the starting point is always the overall theme of the performance and the fundamental ideas of the theater. So the last project I will talk about is Revue. So this is the first issue of Revue, a literary magazine that discusses the world's best literature, one book at a time. The basic idea is to use one book as a prism to discuss different topics. Instead of choosing one subject, such as racism or migration, the topics are attacked with the chosen book as a starting point for the discussion. The first issue deepens in the novel Jazz by Toni Morrison. In the first research phase on the visual identity, we wanted to deepen in book design during a period of time when books were elevated. We visited old archives and antiquarians and looked at book design from the 17 and 1800s. We mainly looked at books that were considered to be particularly good and important. And remember, this was before the modernist period, and was then inspired by how the form and content were integrated with supporting elements such as ornaments. This research has since been revised to reflect Revue's contemporary context, which forms the basis of the magazine's visual identity. However, parts of the design is continuously changing. Each issue of the magazine has a customized font in the headings, as well as customized pointers and ornaments based on the current book's theme. So also the handwritten title on the cover. In the first issue, we have primarily looked at Harlem Renaissance, its form and expression as a visual translation of the novel Jazz. And we have chosen to use the typeface Art Deco in the headings made by Irina Chukina, which we modified with details that we drawn. Other fonts that we use are Mayola by Veronica Burian, that will speak after me, in the body text, and Montserrat by Giulietta Ulanowski in the title of the cover. So, even though you didn't see all images, I hope I managed to give you an idea on how I approach graphic design with typography at the center of it. In general, I believe there is not enough said about how the consumer of our work perceives how we as graphic designers shape the words, how we arrange words into sentences, or how we choose to organize these sentences. And not least, we spend far too little time asking ourselves where and for whom our work is made. The question on how, where, and for whom is for me fully intertwined and has followed me since the very beginning. This question informs and inspires my practice, and at the end of the day, this is what I believe makes sense. Without understanding who's sharing what with who, where, and how, there is no space left for us to have engaged and qualified discussions about the effects of what we do from a broader perspective. And also, the more ways of approaching graphic design we apply, the richer our visual landscape will become. Thank you.